Evening. It is straight up 7 o'clock. We like to start things on time, and we promise to get you out on time. Closing time tonight is midnight, and we'll have you out here by then. So you can hold me to that. Thanks for coming out. You know, you all could have stayed home tonight and put your feet up and watched TV, but you didn't. And by being here, you're demonstrating your commitment to our community. And give yourselves a round of applause for that. That's awesome. My name is Ben Holt, and I've been affiliated with Save the Lakes and efforts to save the open spaces in Ahwatukee for 8 years now. And gosh, it seems like we're changing presidents right now after 8 years, and my term must be about up. So if anybody wants to take over, I can hand it over to them. The steering committee for tonight has spent hours planning this event. And they brought in some very knowledgeable individuals sitting up here. These are guys that really know the community, and they know zoning, and they know legal things, and they know golf. And so I think it's really an impressive panel that we've put together for this program. After each of these panelists have had a chance to speak tonight, we will open the floor to questions. And you're welcome to come up. We're going to set a mic up right up here in the middle, and you can come up and speak to the mic and get your questions answered, we hope. Now, I need to tell you that we can't answer every question, because some of the questions will only be answered probably in a trial. So we won't try to do that. But anything that we can answer, we won't hold anything back. So with that said, it gives me a great pleasure to introduce our moderator for the evening, Mr. Jim Elwood. He's standing over here, and I need to tell you a little bit about Jim. He hardly needs an introduction in this facility because he is the immediate past president of the board of the Ahwatukee Recreation Center. He came here from Scottsbluff, Nebraska, he and his wife Sue. How many years ago, Jim?
6 years
ago. He's an active and, I might say, expert pickleball player. So you'll see him down here frequently in the morning, regardless of how hot it is or how chilly it is, playing pickleball. They came here from Scottsbluff, Nebraska. And if I'm not mistaken, I believe 6 years or 7 years ago, they stopped here kind of on their way to look for a place to retire. And they were planning to maybe go look at the villages in Florida. And I don't think they got there. Did they, Jim?
Went the wrong way.
Yeah, there you go. So anyway, we're glad to have Jim, and let's give him a round of applause. Jim Elwood.
I've got one. Thank you, Ben. My job as moderator tonight is just to introduce these guys and let them take the stage. I do have to say it's nice to be introduced by Ben. He said I was an expert pickleball player. I was in the plumbing and heating business before I retired, and we always thought an expert was a drip under pressure. So expert means nothing to me. I don't see as much of Ben as I have in the past since he's gone back from pickleball to ping pong, but I did see Ben in the mall the other day and saw him from afar, and he saw me just about the same time, and we waved at each other, and Ben came running up to me, and I waited for him, shook his hand, and said, "Jim, I've got great news to tell you." And I said, "Well, good, Ben, what is it?" And he said, "I got a new hearing aid today." And I said, "That's great, Ben, what kind is it?" And he said, 230. Okay, the only ground rules for tonight is, if you feel a sudden surge of adrenaline or emotion that makes you want to stand up and ask a question or make a comment, don't. We will have time after everyone has spoken for you to come up and ask your questions. via the microphone so everybody can hear, all right? So we thank you all for your attendance. So leading off tonight is Jeff Hall. Jeff is a civil engineer, a real estate and construction attorney, a realtor, and most importantly, an Ahwatukee resident. Jeff?
Is this on? How about that? Good evening, everybody. Well, we've got eight panelists up here tonight, and each of us are allotted about 5 minutes. I hope I am less than that. One thing nobody mentioned about me is I'm from the Midwest, probably like the majority of you are out in the audience. I am specifically from Iowa. And if you are from Iowa, you know you will join that esteemed club of being an idiot out walking around. I'm really humbled by being among these other panelists, I will say. I don't know nearly the amount of stuff that they do. I am from Iowa. I'm from a rural community. And I have to say, when I first saw the Ahwatukee Farms concept in the Ahwatukee Foothills News, I was amazed. I was amazed at the beauty of the picture that it presented because it reminded me of the Midwest. And I love the Midwest. I'm proud of the fact that I'm from the Midwest. It reminded me of Mayberry RFD. And we all remember Mayberry RFD. Sitting around our living room, Aunt B, and everybody watching on our black and white television sets back in the day when you had to get up and actually get out of your easy chair, move your butt over to the TV, and change the channel. So it's a great concept. It really is. Makes you feel warm and fuzzy. One of the things I learned in my former days as being a general counsel for a trade association, I did a lot of political work. And one of the things that you learned very early on in politics, and in marketing for that matter, is if you can raise someone's emotions and their passions, usually the use of their intellect, their logic, will go down. And you've got a very, very great marketing piece in front of you called the Ahwatukee Farms. But you know what? All you've got's a concept. So far, Linda, I don't think that they've ever presented anything in writing other than a proposed set of CC&Rs on their website, but they haven't given you any specifics. And the one specific I want to address for you tonight, and then I'll get off the stage, is the traffic conditions that you're going to incur, at least conceivably incur, should this thing go through. Nobody's mentioned that. There's not been a detailed traffic study done because they're not going to spend the money to do that. They're not going to spend the money to do it until they can figure out if they can change the CC&Rs and make the CC&Rs in their control. Now, normal engineering studies, civil engineering days, just 40 years ago now for me, one of the things that you learn in traffic engineering is that there are standards that you go by. And the standards are put together by a group of professionals called the Institute for Traffic Engineering. And the manual that they put out is right there, the Trip Generation Manual. The Trip Generation Manual gives you a whole variety of circumstances and sceneries that you can rely upon this manual. It is a design manual that is used by almost all civil engineering, traffic engineering firms across the country. Now, everybody's familiar with 44th Street, where it goes between Warner-Elliott Loop and the Knox. And everybody's seen how incredibly busy that gets during the morning rush hour and the afternoon rush hour. Back in 2012, which is the latest I could find from the city of Phoenix, the traffic count on the corner of 44th Street and the Warner-Elliott Loop eastbound during the morning was 2,556 vehicles a day on average. In the evening coming back, 2,467 for a total of just over 5,000 vehicle trips per day. That was back in 2012, November of 2012. That's on the City of Phoenix's website. And I'll get you the website address if anybody chooses to go digging into the bowels of cityofphoenix.gov. Only nerds would do that. Actually, when Pulte proposed their little shindig back in 2014, their traffic, they actually did a preliminary traffic study and said that there were over 7,500 cars a day on that road total. I'm going with the city of Phoenix because that's what's been published by the city of Phoenix. Now, back to this little manual. The manual says that when you are putting together a subdivision like this, you need to count on 9.76 vehicle trips per day per household. You can round that up to 10 if you wish for easy math. Vehicle trips per day. That's once from the house to the Fry's grocery store, and then once back, that would be two. So it's five round trips a day. There's been a number of figures thrown around as to how many homes that are going to be put in there. Originally, it was stated as 300 homes. I'm using that number because that's what True Life put out in the newspaper. The math is pretty easy, folks. 300 homes times 10 vehicle trips a day, that's 3,000 additional vehicle trips per day. And where will they all come into and out of? If you've looked at the concept, if you've read what they've stated in the paper, there's only one way in and one way out, and that will be at a roundabout somewhere midpoint on 44th Street. So you're looking at increasing, if you use the City of Phoenix traffic count, you're looking at increasing the traffic from a little over 5,000 vehicle trips a day to around 8,000 vehicle trips a day. If you use Pulte's numbers from 2 years ago, they said there was currently 7,500 vehicle trips a day. Then when you add the additional 3,000, you're now over 10,000 vehicle trips a day. Pulte, I have not confirmed this, and I did not confirm it from the City of Phoenix because I couldn't find it, quite frankly. But Pulte says that the capacity of that road is between 10 and 11,000 vehicle trips per day. In other words, they intend to maximize traffic on that. And if you think you got a problem on 44th Street right now, imagine what it'll be like with an additional 3,000 vehicle trips per day. Just imagine it. It's not hard to imagine. Just think about that. So the really pretty concept that was provided by Ahwatukee Farms in the Ahwatukee Foothills News, and it does remind you of Mayberry RFD, big trees, wide streets, people walking down with their dog on a leash, coffee shop, a school. Oh, and speaking of schools, I didn't add into the traffic count anything for the schools or commercial activity that will be used to support the schools or the coffee shop. I didn't add any of that in. When you start adding that in, it becomes apparent that 44th Street will be a log jam from 7 in the morning until 6 o'clock at night. You could probably walk the length of 44th Street faster than you can drive it if this subdivision goes in. I'm not sure who the second speaker is. I'll add a little closing comment towards the end of the entire presentation. I think, where's Jim? Jim? Tim, should I just give him the microphone or you're going to introduce him?
Thank you, Jeff. Our second speaker this evening is Tim Barnes, an attorney representing Linda and her cohort in litigation suing True Life to enforce the CC&Rs for the Country Club and the Ahwatukee Lakes. Tim?
Thank you. I appreciate Jeff being an Iowa boy. I'm an Iowa boy myself, but I've been here since 1970. So I'm truly a Sun Devil. Not anymore. I really appreciate the opportunity to be here tonight. I was thinking back and I was asking Pete, when was the first meeting we had here? And I can't really remember, but I think it's been probably the better part of 18 months or thereabouts. But I remember at that point in time, we had filed the suit and there were lots of questions and lots of comments and so forth. And I hearkened back to Buddie Johnson, the gentleman sitting over here is actually the gentleman who was responsible for referring me to Ben. And when I sat down with Ben and the group in Ben's house in June or thereabouts of 2014, and they said, well, what do you think? And I said, well, I'll tell you what I think. I've made my living for the last 43 years doing commercial litigation, and a lot of that has been real estate. And while I'm not the guy you would come to write the documents, I'm the guy you'd come to if you want to fight about the documents. And I told Ben and the group that reading the CC&Rs, they were amazingly clear in my mind. And we now have a judge who said that my clear vision of what those CC&Rs require is absolutely what they require. And we have a written order to that effect at this point. So my will be less than 5 minutes because we're now set to go to trial in June of 2017, and the trial will involve asking the court for an injunction to require True Life to restore the golf course and to operate the golf course. The judge has already decided that the CC&Rs presuppose that whoever is owning that golf course is obligated to operate it. That's a fact. That's the ruling. Now the question is, what is going to be done as far as restoring it and operating it? So from my perspective, once Mr. G sold the golf course and True Life became the owner of the course, they obviously bought it understanding completely, with their eyes wide open, to coin a phrase, that what they were buying was a golf course. And the court has said, you bought it, you knew what it was at the time, you know what it's supposed to be when you own it. So that's how I interpret it. So we're in the process now of, we've retained an expert that's gonna help us testify about what it'll take to restore this golf course. And then we'll just see what Judge Hanna rules in June or thereabouts. It might be July. He doesn't have to rule right there during the trial. It'll be a trial just to Judge Hanna. It's not a jury trial. And then he will rule, and from there we'll see where this takes us. So obviously, if we prevail again, I candidly expect that True Life will appeal and take it to the Court of Appeals and challenge Judge Hanna's ruling that he's made already. But Judge Hanna's an amazingly bright gentleman with tremendous experience in a wide variety of legal areas. And so I'm really comfortable with the ruling we have because in my mind, it just wasn't that hard. It was what those CC&Rs required, and therefore let's get back to it because there were conscious decisions made to close the golf course. Now it's up to us to have the court order that you have to restore it and operate it. So I'll answer questions after when the question and answer session comes, but appreciate the moments I've had with you tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we've got a treat. This next up is Wayne Smith. Now, Wayne is the founder of The Farm at South Mountain. If you've ever had occasion to go down there and eat and wander and look around. But his first job was to plan for Mr. Presley the village of Ahwatukee. Wayne, your floor.
Thank you, folks. The last time I was here was celebrating your 40th anniversary. You made fibber out of me. I won't call it a liar, because people always ask how old I am. I always said I'm 40. It was hard to justify that I'm 40 and you all are living in a community that's 40 years old. So now I'm 50 years old, so if that's okay. I'm really pleased to be able to be before you because this, not only did we do the farm at South Mountain, and I'm not plugging it because I don't own it anymore, but we were quite fortunate to be able to do not only Ahwatukee, but Mountain Park Ranch and the foothills and Ocotillo, Gainey Ranch and Scottsdale Ranch, and a number of... Okay, I'm standing too far back. Okay, all right. Do I have to start all over? Okay, thank you. Anyway, I have great joy in the fact that Mr. Presley let us be, Ahwatukee was our first project, and just like your first child, they always seem to have a main soft spot in your heart. So I can say that Ahwatukee has a soft spot in my heart. Just to let you know just a little bit about developments, most generally when a developer wants to take on a large project like this, they will put up money just to hold it, to develop a concept plan and carry it forth from there instead of doing the final working drawings and all. As a part of it, we do what's called constraint studies. We try to know everything we can find out about the site, all the conditions that affect it, whether it's the traffic, whether it's the soils, whether it's the flood drainage. And so we did a preliminary plan, and as you know, this property was in the county at that time. It was not in Phoenix. But to be able to develop a community, you have to have the infrastructure to allow it to happen. You have to have circulation traffic. You have to have infrastructure for sewer and water. And to do all of this, Mr. Presley hired Sudbeck Engineering to give us all the support material that we needed. And at that time, well, even now, the county does not have the capabilities, the facilities for sewer and water. So to carry forth, Ahwatukee had to be a part of a community. It had to a town. The first thing, they went to Tempe to ask, can you annex Ahwatukee into Tempe? Tempe said, no, we don't want it because we don't want Guadalupe in the middle of the community. So they went to Chandler. Chandler said, no, we don't want to go across the freeway. So then they went to Phoenix. Phoenix at that time did not have the capabilities of allowing sewer and water, but they figured it out that that could be done with a lift station down at Ray Road to lift the effluent up over the hill. As you know, this is a hill back here. And to get sewer and water. So it was a natural to go to Phoenix. But prior to that, the master plan, the general plan, was approved by Maricopa County Planning Department. And in the layout of it, the county allowed an overall density of 3.5 units per acre, which was quite acceptable. And as a part of the plan, as it evolved, the real major problem was the drainage that comes off of South Mountain from where the towers all the way on this east end of the mountain. A sizable amount of water was discharged and came right through the property, coming down and was going under the culvert of the freeway south of Warner Road, right behind the Drury Hotel that's there now. I bet you have all seen that big hole and wondered, what in the wide world is that? Well, that was borrow pit to establish the off-ramps for the freeway. And they left it there for the reason to handle the amount of water that was coming down the mountain through the property under the freeway and to fill up, to keep from flooding the Tempe on the far side. I think that we've had some good storms, but there's never been one drip of water ever come through. And the reason is that through the original plan, we designated 18 acres for a pitch and putt golf course in the middle of that drainage way. And when we got the final results from Sudbeck Engineering, they said, whoa, wait a minute, 18 acres is not going to do much. How about pushing it up to 100 acres? And in doing that, that took considerable development land away from Presley. But by putting a golf course in, it does one of two things. or there's two factors that justify. Golf courses are economic and they're recreational. They can recuperate some of the money that they lost in developing. If it's 100 acres, 3.5 units per acre, that's 350 units that Mr. Presley couldn't build. So how is he going to recoup that money? It's not off of the sale of the land, but it's about putting the premiums on all the properties adjacent to the golf course. That helps recuperate. The other factor, it's called health, safety, and public welfare. That's a mandate that most municipalities govern their whole operation. If I were to put a value on that golf course, I would say the value is 10% economic and recreation, 90% health, safety, and public welfare, and what it does in protecting all of you who live around it. Because if the amount of water coming down off of the mountain were not channelized and were not kept within the confines, it would fan out into the whole community, or a large part of it. Mr. Presley hired Gary Panks, a local well-known architect, landscape architect, golf course architect, to design an executive golf course. He did a masterful job in earth sculpturing, and it's how it get its name. It's because of the lakes. The lakes really are the saving grace, because they have what's called freeboard, and water coming down would go into the lake would fill up, it would ooze over to the next lake, and so forth. So that's kept it from getting into the community. So that's the health, safety, and welfare of it. It's protected all of you, because it would have fanned out greatly. Do you have the, yes, thank you. I think you can see from the map here, the water comes down, all the way down through here, down and to the freeway, which is all the way at the bottom. There's a number of lakes, as you know now, but again, with this proposal, you can see this is like putting a dam in the middle of that drainage way. Can you imagine how the water is to verse through all of these houses, through the streets? The overflow, it's not going to just affect the people in here. All of you who live in this area, are subject to receiving that water that is coming down. And I'm sure if it were safe, Mr. Presley would have built houses in there, because it was part of his scheme. But he was gracious enough to, I think, lose some of the equity of the homes into putting in the golf course. So I think you can see visually another factor that you might remember. Not too long ago, 2 years ago, I think it was, we had a major storm. And on the north side of the mountain, from Central Avenue over to 7th Avenue, all the houses got flooded, because the water coming off of the mountain, when they laid out the subdivisions, they were paralleling the mountain, and the water had no place to go but through the houses. But on the opposite side, from Central Avenue to 16th Street, the old Thunderbird Country Club was there, the earth sculpturing, the lakes that they had, not a drip of water went through under Dobbins Road into the subdivision north of it. That's the same issue. That was, you all experienced water coming through the project at that time, but it was kept from really doing the damage that happened on the other side because of the golf course. So I think the main thing I'd like to leave with you is, I think my love for the project and for the the way it was designed as far as the golf course goes, in creating a lifestyle that's healthy and good and safe for you. I think with this, you can see how difficult it's going to be to traverse that amount of water through all those houses. And I think they have a little farm area there that should, probably will never accommodate the kind of overflow that will be coming. I think with that, I'll leave it. If you have questions later on, I'll be happy to answer. But I just want you to know my love for the community is great enough that I feel I can speak out and say, please, please be careful in allowing something to happen that will interfere with your lifestyle. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Wayne. Our next panelist is Buddie Johnson. Buddie is a golf course appraiser, a Methodist minister, and he built and operated Las Sendas Golf Course in Mesa. Buddie.
Thank you. I just spotted over here a guy that you all should know. Doc Graves is a legendary golfer, friend of golf, very active for many, many years. I won't say how old you are, Doc, with the Arizona Golf Association. The record holder for score at the Lakes Golf Course and other golf courses. If you want to know what this golf course was like before it closed, go by and see Doc before you go, and he'll give you a straight up story. I'm just going to take a couple minutes just to lay out the side for golf. There's been a lot of talk as this issue has continued to go on and on and on that this golf course was not feasible to begin with. Going through the recession and the housing downturn and everything, this golf course should have died anyway because it wasn't. Golf was not viable anymore. I think I can shoot that down a little bit. We never have received the figures on the number of rounds run and the kind of income produced under the previous owner of this golf course when it was operating. But we have some folks here who are going to enlighten you on the operation. Plus, I made a study on this in 2014 that pretty much aligns with actually the numbers that they've produced. I have been appraising golf courses for almost 50 years. I know I don't look that old, but all over the country, I've seen a lot of golf courses, worked on a lot of problems on golf courses, particularly from the playing and the financial end of things. Some of those golf courses are pretty famous golf courses that you would know. Lately, there's been a lot of talk in the press and everything about golf courses dying, and if you read some of these reports, nobody's going to be playing golf in 10 years and so on. Well, that simply is not true. There are 15,200 golf courses in the country right now. During the 80s and 90s and into the early 2000s, the country was going nuts for golf. Tiger Woods appeared in the mid-90s, and that led to another big step in golf and excitement and so on. But at any rate, they built too many golf courses. Now, how'd that happen? Because we were doing pretty good economically as a country, and guys were getting rich, and families were buying second homes and buying really expensive lots in very remote places. And as these developments were built over the years, many of them, they just figured they had to have a golf course to sell their lots and the homes. And not too many of them gave a whole lot of thought about how they were going to exit that project once all the homes and the real estate was bought. But the most sophisticated some of them ever got was, we'll just sell it to the members or the residents. We wound up, not very many of those folks were very excited about owning and operating a golf course, period. They wanted to play, but not own it. During the recent recession, say in the last 10 years, we've lost about 800 golf courses. And there's going to be more. And those golf courses that we're losing pretty much should be going the way that they're going. And they should be off of the books. We had too many golf courses, and the business itself is actually just like any other business. It's coming back to equilibrium. And probably in the next 2 or 3 years, you're going to see the continued pace of losing 125 to, say, 160 golf courses a year. And finally, it'll get down to a number where we won't be talking so much about losing. Golf is a game of passion. And I can tell you, I've been so involved in it, and I know I'm biased, but I can tell you that golf is not going away. How many golfers do we have in here? You want to turn your clubs in tonight and not play anymore? I'll bet you not a one of them would do it. It's a game that either grabs you by the throat or you just hate it instantly. But there are a lot of golfers. In fact, I'm holding the paper because there's some numbers on here I don't want to mess up. In fact, there are, if I can find my numbers here, there are about 24 million golfers in the country. That number varies. It comes and goes. One time they said there was about 30 million. Another time they said there was 24 million or 22 million. But it hangs in there generally around 24, 25 million players. And these people play an enormous number of rounds every year. In fact, it's estimated that there are probably 465 million rounds of golf. And if you divide the number of golf courses, 15,200, and it's too easy to do, but it's roughly, but that comes down to about 30,500 rounds of golf on a golf course. And there are a lot of golf courses that do about 8 or 10 or 12 a year. So in general, a good golf course will run better than that. My contention is, when I first got into this project and started to study, and by the way, I was attracted to this project because I had just moved back from San Francisco down to Phoenix in 2013, and I get up real early in the morning, and about 4:30, and the paper comes at 5, and I every day read the paper for about an hour and drink coffee, and I found this little Ahwatukee Tempe section that goes into the paper, you know. And I started reading about this golf course that was closing. And usually I work for the guy that owns the golf course. The more I kept reading this every day, and there was an article at least twice a week on this golf course, and you remember that time when they were discussing this, I got madder and madder because I was trying to figure out a way, how do I get a hold of this guy that owns it? I found out who he was, and maybe because he might need my help. Well, it turns out the more I read about this whole deal, the more pissed off I got at what was happening to the homeowners. And I didn't know anybody, any one of you who lived out here. And a friend of mine recommended me to this group, and I finally started meeting with him. And sure enough, the contention was that this golf course couldn't make money. The water was shut off. You got an inland desert out there, and it just didn't make any sense to me. So in terms of what are we looking at here, my contention is that this golf course not only can work, but it's highly feasible. We don't know what it's going to cost to restore it. It would have been a lot less in 2013 than right now. But you got 80,000 people within a 3-mile radius, generally, of that golf course. When you talk about feasibility, that's a pretty good deal. You got a short golf course. It's an executive golf course. It takes less time to play. It costs less money for a green fee on a golf course like that. You have not only the freeway, but all the arterials that lead into here. You get, when we look at the feasibility of a golf course, everything that, that I typically would look for in establishing the feasibility of a course, you got it in spades here. And plus, within 10 minutes, you have all of these people who are generally affluent. I don't know if you, and there's numbers all over the place, but generally, the numbers on the residents are very, very compatible with successful golf. Median income here is about household income, about $93,000. Average household income is about $105,000. If you were going to sit down and draw up a classic case study for the feasibility of an executive length golf course in an urban community, and we're not talking about a golf course up in Carnville, we're talking about right here in the heart of Ahwatukee and Phoenix, Tempe. I mean, and these guys are going to tell you how successful an executive golf course could be. That's what you'd find. So hold in there. We're going to try to help you as much as we can, and I don't know if we can get there, but I think we can. But it's going to have patience and a lot of support from you folks to take up behind Eileen and Linda and helping them, because they got a lot of guts and strength in taking this thing through the court system with you. And I'll be glad to answer any questions you have afterwards.
Thank you. Thank you, buddy. Thank you. Our next panelist, ladies and gentlemen, is Don Ray, member of the Professional Golfers Association. He is the owner and operator of Augusta Ranch Golf Course in Mesa. He is a board member of the National Golf Course Owners Association and the Arizona National Golf Course Owners Association, and most recently named a board member to the PGA of America. Don Ray.
Thank you. I appreciate that. You know, sometimes I think about all those committees I'm on, and you might go out there and say, well, God, he must really like golf. Or his wife really doesn't like seeing him. But you know what I do? I like golf. There's no doubt about it. But you know what? I love people. And you know what? And golf has never killed business. It hasn't. But sometimes business can kill golf. You know, at Augusta Ranch, and, you know, I'm fortunate to be one of the owner-operators of Augusta Ranch, and although my other investors are never there, so I think I'm on my own sometimes. But, you know, what I discovered a long time ago, it's not what you do, it's why you do it, right? People don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it. And at Augusta Ranch, if you came out there, how many people have been to Augusta Ranch? Raise your hand, okay. Well, I encourage you to go out there and don't play. That's okay. I mean, I'd love for you to play, but it's not a sales pitch. But what I'd love you to do is feel what you feel when you're out there. A month ago, we had a community picnic on our driving range. There were 3,500 people on our driving range. There were rock walls. There were bounce houses. There were kids. There were families. There were millennials. There were the millennials' kids, which now they're calling the centennials. Someone coined that phrase. But there were people having a good time. On December 9th, we're going to have a Christmas night. And we're going to have Santa Claus there. And we ask all the homeowners to decorate their backyards. And we do cart tours throughout the golf course so that people can see those lights. And we do a big movie night where there's a 50-foot inflatable screen that's there. And there'll be 800 people there. We got a horse carriage ride through the community. We're actually going to have a snow slide. It keeps getting bigger every year because more people want to participate. So there'll be a big 20-foot snow slide. And thankfully, we're insured, but it's gonna be a good time. And we do bike rides on the golf course. And we do glow golf every other week. We do 100 people a glow golf. They all pay $35 for 9 holes. I mean, it's crazy. We do the cornhole, the beanbag tournaments. We do that every Thursday. There's a big group of guys who come out in the parking lot. Sometimes we do it on the driving range during, we used to have the turkey toss where we had a big tournament on the, or we had a big tournament on the driving range. So when I think about golf, and people say, oh, you know, when I wrote that white paper, I just got tired of seeing everybody say that golf is dead. Golf is dead. Maybe golf a long time ago is dead, when dad was gone for 8 hours on a Saturday playing with his buddies. That doesn't happen anymore. My daughter's on a club softball team, and I'm all worried about, you know, the specialization of the youth into the game, and I get it. But I'm almost at every practice. The only reason I'm not there tonight is because I'm here. And we go to every game. And millennial parents are at every game because they're going to participate in what their kids are doing. And guess what? Kids are getting into golf. You know, the number one youth sport in the last 5 years is golf. It's growing faster than anything else. 25% it's up. Because these centennials, they like to play in teams. They like to figure things out. They don't want to have as much fun maybe as their millennial parents, who are all about fun. We all know about those off-the-grid people. But, you know, they're digging it. And this weekend at Greyhawk is the national championship for the PGA Junior League. This amazing event where boys and girls play together, ages 6 through 13. They have numbers on their back. They play a two-man scramble. Golfers, explain that to the non-golfers. Two-man scramble, and they can switch teammates every third hole. So everybody gets engaged. And when they have the during the season, good golfers are playing with bad golfers. 13-year-olds are playing with 7-year-olds. These kids are embracing this, and you're going to see more of it. The Golf Channel is going to do a big deal on it this weekend. We're trying to drive, especially now in my national position, is I want this to be the Williamsport of golf out here. This national championship should be at Greyhawk every year. We have the weather, we have the people, and golf is growing. Because millennials might not be playing as fast as everybody thinks, but if their kids are going to play, they're going to start playing. And maybe the father and daughters and the father and sons aren't going as fast as they used to be. But I'll tell you what's big, grandfathers and granddaughters. Grandfathers and grandsons, because, you know, the next generation, we're just trying to, you know, save up more money because the economy hit us. But those are the things that you can do to make a golf course feel community. I'm not on either side. I'm on golf's side. I'm here just to say that I truly believe that golf doesn't kill business. I think if you're about money, if you're about the money, it's always about the money. That's all it's ever going to be about. And I've never done that at Augusta Ranch. When we bought it in 2007, it wasn't losing money, but it wasn't making much. And the last 3 years have been the best 3 years in the history of the golf course. We do 42,000 rounds, 43,000 rounds of golf. We gross $1.3 million in revenue, and we're profiting about $130,000. I don't own the restaurant. I outsource it to somebody who knew what they were doing. And now the view is an amazing place where people used to go to Scottsdale to have a good glass of wine or a craft beer or a bruschetta. But they're coming to the golf course. So for the first time, there isn't a restaurant at a golf course. There's a golf course at a restaurant. You know, there's a lot of restaurants going out of business. But no one says food's dead. No one's stopping eating. Right? Somebody else fills the spot. And another operator comes in. Thanks. Just make sure you tip your waiters and your waitresses and we'll be good to go. But I truly believe that. I have nothing against, I know the operators of the golf course. They're actually good friends of mine. But I know sometimes a location, a new blood comes in and all of a sudden people start going. I've seen it happen at Augusta Ranch when we first took over. Because that little picnic I told you about, that used to be at the school. The first thing I did is says that thing is coming into the golf course because the developer did not get along with the HOA. Community Southwest did not get along with Augusta Ranch HOA. So the first thing, we had to fix it. So we put that picnic on the driving range. You know what's funny? I never even thought about it. Is it was the best thing ever because now parents could sit on the tee, and since there's nets on both sides of it, they know their kids can't go anywhere. They have to come this way. So that's all I want to say is that I believe there are some golf courses that are going to close. It's going to happen. We're getting close to where it needs to be, but it's going to happen. But did this golf course have to close? I mean, I see the community around it, and I see a lot of the same faces that I would see at Augusta Ranch right now. And to be quite honest with you, us as owners, we're selling the golf course to the HOA. And then I'm going to lease it back from the HOA for the next, you know, hopefully 5 to 10 years. Because I believe their best security is to own that golf course. And it makes money. And I'll make my rent check, my lease payment every month, and they'll be just fine. But in 6 months, we got 1,200 people to sign off that they would buy that golf course. And it's because the messaging was right. It was because it felt good at Augusta Ranch, and it was a community situation. It wasn't a golf course and a community. It was a community golf course. And that's not just because there were rounds of golf. It was because of the bike rides, and it was because of the movie nights, and it was because of all the things that you do to embrace people. I'm sure this community center is very busy. But I just wonder where all the millennial families are. And the ones that are coming into these houses even now, homes are flipping, right? I mean, that's what's happening. And these millennials, they love community. And they love to be around more people. And man, I cannot think of a better place to do that than a golf course. Because right now, the cities, their budgets are strapped. They can't do the events they used to. I mean, maybe the Ostrich Festival is crazy off the hook, but the little weekend events that you used to have, they're just not out there. And golf courses can do that because there's 85 acres of land, and it's just not for golf. It's for foot golf. It's for glow golf. It's for walkathons. It's for races. It's for movie nights. It's for cornhole tournaments. It's for whatever you want it to do. So that's what I would encourage you, that golf is not dead. And there is somebody out there who would say, this is an incredible opportunity. And it might be me. It might not. I don't know. This is America. But I know somebody looks at that and says, man, I'd love to make a community out of that. And it's not going to be about me getting my return on my investment in 5 years. Because if I wanted to do that, I wouldn't get in golf anyways. It's a tough sport, especially if you want to make a business out of it. But if you have a love for people, and whoever operates this golf course loves golf and loves people, they will be successful because you guys will buy in and you will be there and you'll tell your friends about it. And that's what I just urge you to do. That's the solution, in my opinion. When, not if, when this becomes a golf course, buy in.
Thank you, Don. Thank you. Thank you, Don. Our next panelist is R.J. Hawley, PGA of America. Don served the country for 27 years in the United States Marine Corps. Thank you for your service. Don is also an Arizona State University Business School graduate. He is the owner of Millenium Golf Management, which manages the golf courses for the city of Tempe. R.J.?
How y'all doing tonight? Okay, so I know it looks like the Iowa Hawkeyes football team's up here with all the Iowa Hawkeyes over here, but we did handle Michigan pretty good this last week. I'm going to tell you. How y'all doing tonight? Hey, it's great to see everybody out here. I mean, it's great to see support for a community coming together and saying, hey, you know what? This is where the grassroots of golf is going to start. And, you know, it's important that when I got involved with golf, I didn't even pick up a golf club till I was 21. So it was pretty weird. I was like, oh, man, I don't know if I'm going to play golf or not. Because I did wrestling, track, and tennis in high school, so I never picked up a golf club. So I said, geez, man, I love this thing. Geez, I went out there, I like had a par on like the fifth hole. I'm pretty sure I counted all my shots too, buddy. Stopped at Walmart on the way home, bought a box set of Golden Bears, Jack Nicklaus Golden Bears. It was $100. Box, the pull cart, the bag, everything was there. It was awesome. And I've been playing golf ever since. And when I retired, I met a guy. First place I ever played was Desert Hills Golf Course down in Yuma, Arizona. A Muni. And I used to love to go over to Royal Dunes. How many people know where Royal Dunes is? Oh, my gosh. It's an 18-hole lit golf course. Par 59. It's awesome. It's an awesome golf course. You can play it at night. It's awesome. So that's where I learned to play and learned to love golf. And I was still in the Marine Corps. I was stationed right there in Yuma, Arizona, MCAS. And so retired as a Sergeant Major in 2003. And a pro there, Don King, who ran that, he runs the one over in California right now, one of the casino golf courses over there, Barona or something. And he says, you know, you ought to get in this PGM program over at ASU. He says, you'd be perfect for golf. I says, I don't know about that. Sure enough, I graduated. I literally retired in July and started at ASU in August of 2003. And then I graduated with my master's in 2008. So I just got done with schoolwork just a few years ago. And it was tough, but, you know, it's good to go. But, you know, I love the Marine Corps, and then I got involved with the PGA. And I'll tell you, I taught at ASU. I taught the students there in the professional golf management program. My baccalaureate degree is in business, but my I have a minor in professional golf management, where I got my PGA certification. And really saw, holy cow, this is like the golf mecca. This is awesome. You know, people come by, they drop their kids off, and they say, you know, hey, you got them. We bring them in, we play golf with them, teach them a little bit of etiquette, teach them a little bit of leadership. I also I helped over at the first tee right over there. It's South Mountain right over there by Vestal. Oh, yeah, that's right. It's not a golf course anymore. They're building houses over there now. First tee, we used to do about 100 kids. Every weekend, we'd go over there. We'd teach them. Each hole was named for a certain, trying to build certain values that golf teaches. Well, I don't know what's going to happen to it now, but there's a lot of golf courses that are really helping out. I know Don's big in trying to build some satellite. You know, all the golf courses trying to do some satellite first tee programs now, but that was a huge first tee program over there. So I remember helping out with that, and it's pretty, you know, I always wanted to try and do a little bit more of that. So I was one of the first people laid off at the Polytechnic campus for ASU. Hey, Dr. Crow just didn't like it. I don't know. So I was laid off, and I wasn't worried about it. Heck, I just put together a little business plan, went over to Talk of Sticks. So there you go. I'll be your director of teaching. They didn't have any teaching programs. Here you go. Gave it to the GM. He called me up the next day, said, come on over here. I ended up the head pro about 3 months after that because they let the guy go. The thing about that is when I got laid off at ASU, I was like going, you know what? I'm just going to start my own business. That way, if I get laid off, it's my fault. Plus, I can give myself a raise. That's the best part. So anyway, so I started Millenium Golf Management, had two other partners, ended up already buying them. I bought them out a few years ago, but my last one just a year ago. And we were awarded the contract for Ken McDonald Golf Course and Rolling Hills. Anybody hear of those golf courses? Well, if you didn't know, when I came in 2011, actually in December of 2011, I want to say, the city council was voting on whether to privatize those two golf courses. Why? Because Ken McDonald and Rolling Hills had lost over $800,000 a year for the prior 4 years. And they said, you cannot run these two golf courses. It is a losing proposition. Turn it over to the private. We'll lease it to them. We'll let them run it and let them do what they need to do with it. And again, you hear all this floodplain stuff. Let me tell you, at Kenny Mack, it's a floodplain also. It absorbs all the water coming in. It absorbs so much that we built a recharge well. Recharge well literally takes all the extra water that comes in, charges it, and we throw it back into SRP. And they got what's called a mag meter. So, you know, you can, like, track amount of water. You get back to them so you can, like, get a credit on your bill. So at Kenny Mack, we put down about 1 million gallons of water a day during overseed, which is during the winter when we're all right out. So from about 1 November through April, we're doing about 1 million gallons a day is what we put on that golf course. And the water bill was $30,000, about 31 something. That's pretty good, you know. And Ahwatukee's got great little water rights. They got their own wells. You guys don't pay much for water. That's great. So I took over in 2011, took over both golf courses. Kenny Mack was doing, they were doing right around 42,000 rounds a year. And the average price of golf there was about $7.30. I know, tough to make a buck at that, isn't it? Hate to hear those numbers. And Rolling Hills was doing about 32 to 34,000, and it was pretty bad over there too. So now here we're going to fast forward. We grew it. Got more rounds. This last year, Kenny Mack had 63,000 something rounds. It makes our budget over there is $2.6 million is our budget for golf, both golf courses. And we've been in the black all 5 years that I've been there. And you know, golf isn't a secret. It's not a secret to run that. It's because golf is something that you do for life. It's not something that you say, oh gee, I'm gonna buy this house and I got it on the golf course and then I'm gonna sell it and make all this money. It's not about money. It's not. And I remember over at Rolling Hills, it's funny because the people would drive up, drop their kids off. The kids would come in and we'd have them and they'd go out and they hit the balls and we'd have a little lunch special for them and they're playing golf and the parents come back about 3 o'clock, pick them up, off they go. The mayor over at Tempe grew up on, well, all the council members over there, Robin Ardondo, all those, they all grew up on Kenny Mack and Rolling Hills. And can you make it? Absolutely, you can make it. The numbers here, once you get this golf course back open, I'm going to tell you that through Golf Now and through the marketing that you can do, and we did some numbers, and I mean, we're talking about modest numbers here. We're talking, say, 38,000 rounds. That's nothing for you. The top executive golf course, you had the top executive golf course. You had it. Well, it might not be look so much now, but back then it was awesome. I mean, I played it many, many times. It's very difficult to shoot par on that golf course. Modest rounds, 38,000, and let's say that you average price anywhere from 19 to 20 bucks, which, you know, 18 holes, 19 to 20 bucks, that's, we average right now, Rolling Hills is right in, I kind of benefited when you closed down there, something kind of came over there. But literally, if you open that up, $38,000, and you're making about $19 to $20, you're talking about $780,000 a year. $780,000 a year. Once this golf course is running, then it is not going to take long at all for this golf course to get back exactly where is that and surpass that, because community grassroots golf, it's here. People, you go over to Greyhawk, you stand out there, you don't see a whole lot of kids going into Greyhawk. You will this week because there's a lot of them coming in. But most of those golf courses, people can't afford to sit, to spend $300 and $400 a month on their kids to play golf. But you know what they can do? They can come over to a municipal golf course, and if that operator has a $30 monthly pass or a $50 monthly junior pass, and the kid can come over there and he can show up and check in with the pro and come out there and play some golf, he's going to learn some values. He's going to learn responsibility, ownership, and he's going to grow, just like you are right now. I mean, look around. There ain't too many young people in here. Where did you start golf? Think about it. Where did you start golfing? Did you start at Greyhawk, or did you start, like me, at a municipal golf course? It's where grassroots of golf grow. It's where we start and keep the game of golf going. And you know what? It builds communities. It doesn't kill communities. It doesn't kill business. It literally builds and brings communities together. And I'm going to tell you that, I can't wait to see what happens. Because when Buddy brought me in on this, and I looked at his thing, and he asked me, he says, what do you think you could do over there? I said, are you kidding? I said, that place should have absolutely no problem running and being successful and continuing to build on what they have over there. So I wish you the absolute best luck. Dig your feet in and don't give up. It might seem like it takes a long time, but I'm telling you, you got a great group of people here that are rooting for you and telling you to hang in there. So go get it.
Thank you, RJ. Thank you. So you think it can never be a golf course again, huh?
Yeah.
Our next panelist is Lou Wilmot. Lou was vice president of engineering for Presley when he started this project oh so many years ago. Lou?
Hi, everyone. As I drove up out here in the parking lot, I thought about the day, it kind of come rolling back to me, that we started this building. It's a nasty rainy day, and I was checking out the surveyors. They were starting to lay the building out, and they were in the mud, and it was a mess, so it kind of logged in my memory. But the thing that stuck with me the most is I realized that I was 30 years old. And when I left here and went back over to Dan Verska's office, because we had a meeting with the land planner, and as I walked in, I said, who's that old guy? 50 is not the truth. That was 45 years ago. You've heard just about everything tonight that I think you want to hear about golf courses and how well they fit the community, and that's why it's done originally anyway. And we've heard about the problems with the floods and with the traffic, and all these things are going to happen. If this project goes through. But before that happens, everyone in this room has a big responsibility to themselves and to the community to make sure that it doesn't pass that city council down there. Now, they can have all the attorneys they want. They can get land planners and planning commissioners, the planning department. The only people that can write legislation in the city is the council. And if the council does not approve whatever they may submit, and you know, we've seen what they're talking about submitting, in my own professional opinion, it will never fly downtown. But you need to talk to your neighbors, and if they're not listening, grab them by the collar a little bit. Convince them not to be signing that consent thing, because that's going to start the ball rolling. And then that's going to have quite a few months, maybe years, before that's going to play out with all the illegal gymnastics and so on and forth. And then when New Life files their application for zoning, they may or may not get it. If they don't get it, they'll probably drop the deal. There's no point in going forward if they don't have the zoning. And that could be stopped at the zoning commission level. But if the zoning commission decides it's okay and they haven't received any pressure from you people, they might do that. Recommend it for approval and send it on to the city council. If it goes to the city council and they haven't had enough pressure from this group, they might approve it. But myself, I've got a one-man little program that I've got for myself where I'm working on Sal DeCiccio, the city councilor. You probably all know Sal. And he's got to go and start putting together some votes. It's there where he can assure everyone that, yeah, he has enough votes to stop this thing. And that's the name of the game right there. All of these people here are undoubtedly very well versed in golf and could redo the golf course, get it up and running again, and it would be beautiful. But it won't happen unless we stop the legal process at the city. And it's becoming, a lot of people that I know in California even have heard about this place and what's going on. Because to lift CC&Rs and put something else on top after it's already been through the process and the legal process, they're destroying the integrity of the entire development process. And that's what keeps us from being tent dwellers. I'm through. We've gone along far enough.
Thank you, Lou. Does anybody in this room know Pete Meier? Pete's our last moderator. Pete's the an Ahwatukee original, the vice president of sales for Presley. He's been a realtor in the Ahwatukee area since 1973. Wow. And he is currently a member of the Ahwatukee Foothills Village Planning Committee. Pete.
Thank you all for coming and showing the community support. The last time I saw this many people here was in the spring when we had free ice cream. Ice cream, so people had to park in the post office to get over here. Probably had to do that tonight, you know. So anyway, when we all bought in Ahwatukee, we bought into a certain lifestyle. Ahwatukee was master planned with 2,500 acres of single-family homes, retirement homes, young adult homes, open space, two golf courses, a tennis club, which we lost part of, and we fought to get six courts back. And now we're threatened with the loss of this golf course. This golf course means a lot to the community. You know, it's not just golf, it's the open space. People who buy on golf courses don't just buy because they like golf. They like no neighbors behind them. They like the open spaces. Some people are saying, well, look at the golf course now. It just looks like dirt. It looks like desert. Well, about a half a mile over from the golf course, there's equestrian estates and the custom area. people pay $500,000 for a lot just to back to the desert. Why? Because no one's behind them. So the people at the lakes, they would rather look at dirt than rooftops, another 300 homes. The master plan was approved by the county first in the 70s, and then later we were strip annexed by the city of Phoenix because they saw the tax values in the community, they saw the price of houses going up, and they saw it as a good investment, and then eventually they annexed us, and they also approved of this master plan that we're operating under now, and which some people are trying to change. Hopefully that won't happen. Some of the houses around that lakes community and golf course, they have lost some value. They have lost $50,000 to $65,000 a house, those that are directly on the golf course. The houses across the street, they've also suffered. They've lost value. The whole community has lost value. You know, you may have just lost 5%. Some realtors are saying we've lost 30%. I think that's a little strong, but 5% and 10% for sure, because the values have not risen because the level of anxiety in the community, and people are afraid to buy into something that they don't know what's going to be for sure. But you yourself, you've got to vote. You want a golf course, you can have a golf course. The legal process is going forward, and there's a trial date in June, and it should be settled by then. So don't give your rights away to a developer. It's like the old story about the gold mine. They get the gold, and we get the shaft. Thank you.
You know, I'm sitting here listening to Buddie Johnson and all these guys, and it dawned on me that when Buddie said he moved back to Phoenix and he was reading all these articles about why the owner wasn't getting in touch with him, and, you know, the story's been made that he couldn't make this golf course operate. Linda, would you bring up a slide that shows the amount of money that was paid for the golf courses? That's the wrong one. This is a document that's known as an affidavit of property value. Now, Wilson G paid $5.6 million for both golf courses, the Ahwatukee Country Club and the Lakes Golf Course. On a transaction, and I think Mr. Barnes here will confirm this, typically after a real estate transaction, you record a document called this affidavit of property value. And you voluntarily do that. You voluntarily identify the valuation you want to give to the property. Property was purchased for $5.6 million, both golf courses. The valuation that Mr. G gave to the Lakes Golf Course was $4 million. The valuation he gave to the Ahwatukee Country Club was $1.6 million. Now use your heads. Does that make sense? Now, I can't get into the mind of Wilson G, but you can conclude in looking at numbers and determine for yourself what the motivation was when he gave that property a $4 million valuation. Because in the likelihood that he might want to sell it at a later point in time for development, gee, what a far-fetched idea that might be. That would be his tax basis. So if he were to sell it at a higher price, the gain that he makes is reduced. So now I ask you, these are the facts. You conclude for yourself what his motivation was. And then when you listen to the story that Mr. Johnson gave you, and he said he never got a phone call, yet he is in the golf course emergency revival business, if I can coin a phrase, I think it, you can draw your own conclusions. I'm not going to tell you what his motivation was, but the numbers are hard to argue with. Mr. G is not an Ahwatukee resident. He lives in California. He's a developer. You've just got through hearing a bunch of professional gentlemen who make their living in the world of golf and in the world of community development. Ask yourself, was the Lakes Golf Course intended to be a community asset under Mr. G's vision? Think about that before you agree to sign your CC&R rights away. Thanks.
For questions, now we've got the building until 9 o'clock, so that gives us 45 minutes. You gonna carry this, Ben? Don't drop it. Yes. Anyone has a question, just come forward. We'll put the mic in here, and you are welcome to speak. You're in my way, Ben. That's usual.
You're always in the way, Ben. When you speak, speak into the top of the mic. That's where it will pick up the sound. Yes, state your name and just indicate, yes, you are a resident. And hello, sir.
Hi.
How are you tonight?
Fine.
Good.
Speak into the top of the mic. Can I turn around and talk to these people?
Absolutely. Okay. If you can get by me. Okay, go for it.
Hey, Jim and I are good friends, so don't mess with me. Okay. My name's Roger LaPointe. I live over there in Center Court. Been here a long time, 20 years. I have a question for somebody up here. And I have been told that the CC&Rs for the Lakes Course and the Ahwatukee Course are combined. If you sign away one, you're signing away for both of them. What do you think is going to happen to Ahwatukee Country Club if you sign away the CC&Rs? Can anybody verify that? Is that a correct statement?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a correct statement. How long do you think it'll take Mr. G to sell the country club as soon as he gets those CC&Rs changed? He will do it. Trust me. And going back to what Jeff was saying about the property here, and this is my opinion, so if you want to boo somebody, you can boo me. When Mr. G, and by the way, Mr. G is not a majority owner of that golf course. I have been told he has 5%, something like that. When he bought that golf course, if you looked at the progression of how he let that course go downhill day after day after day, and then turned around and says, we're not making any money. Well, I guarantee you, if you turn the best golf course, executive golf course in the city into a piece of junk, nobody's gonna come play it. His intention when he bought that golf course, those two golf courses, was to always sell that Lakes property. That's my opinion. You don't have to agree with it. But be aware that if you change the CC&Rs for the Lakes course, it changes the ones at Ahwatukee Country Club. So that's all I got to say.
Hi. My name is Pamela Keating. Some of you may know me. Some of you may get to know me. All the personal, not small issues, about why we want to maintain what we have are overridden, I think, by we are part of Phoenix. This is land, and it's taxable, and somebody has to maintain it, and somebody has to make money on it, and maybe the ABM also wants to make money on it. That's it.
I'm Carol McMaster Guy, and I've lived
pardon me, in Ahwatukee basically since 1981. My question is, when you talk about signing away our CC&R rights, which is it all of the Presley subdivisions, or is it just the HOAs that surround the golf courses? Who are we looking to avoid sign the CC&R away?
The CC&Rs overlay the golf courses, both golf courses, the lakes and the championship golf course. Change one, chances are that other one's going right behind it. And it would set up precedent. ABM is not part of that. They have no jurisdiction over the golf course per se. They have jurisdiction over the individual subdivisions that you live in. They do the drive-bys, they check your yards, send you a letter about weeds and things like that. But they have no responsibility directly for the golf courses or the CC&Rs. They get one vote. They're considered a benefited party when it's time to vote or sign your waiver or a rescission form, whatever they have. They've got one vote just like you do.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Now, we all live in different subdivisions, RTV1, RTV2, whatever. Is it just the people in the subdivisions that surround the courses who are in danger of signing away their rights, or is it everybody in the Presley homes?
The whole community of 5,200 homes, all of Ahwatukee. Oh, the borders of Ahwatukee, Greater Ahwatukee, you know where Elliott Road is? That's the northern border, all the way to the mountains. The eastern border is I-10. The southern border is Knox Road, all the way back up to the Catholic Church. Then it jogs around a little bit to the two schools, the junior high school and the elementary school, Canyon Heights, in the custom area directly behind that, and then the mountains are the back boundary. That's the whole area.
And those all belong to ABM and therefore have a right to sign.
They all have a right to sign, yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So spread the word to your neighbors.
Come up.
Good evening. My name's Chris Room, and I've lived here in Ahwatukee since 1988. I was fortunate enough to move in on a street with Mr. Meier and Mr. Wilmot there. They're longtime friends of mine. But in any event, my question may be for Mr. Hawley, Mr. Ray. With the amount of money that True Life paid for for the lakes course area, and the estimation that Mr. G put on there, the $4 million. In your gentleman's opinion, what would another golf course developer be willing to pay for that 100 acres in its current condition?
You're on.
Am I on?
The microphone is on.
Can you hear me?
No.
Can you hear me now?
Or I'll trade you.
Golf course valuation, which is what I do, is a very eccentric practice. It's a mystery. We like
that's
to keep
mute.
It that way.
That is and mute. Press that like that, that's mute.
Make everybody think that
so
it's...
So I'm on now?
But here's how you determine the value of a golf course. You look at what is... how do you get to the bottom line? We call it the NOI, the net operating income. And you go through all these gyrations to get to it. How many rounds could you play at what price, and what are the expenses, and so on. And I've lived with this, like I say, for 50 years, so I know a little bit about that end of it. But you're not always right, but it's, you get in the ballpark of it. And in this thing, you would determine what, and it's your opinion, but determine what is the potential net operating income for that golf course. What could it make? Bottom line. And then you apply a cap rate, capitalization rate to it. And this is kind of the mystery, and I'm not going to bore you with all that. But at any rate, you come out, you know, if you get $200,000 and you apply a 10% cap rate, and you get a value of $2 million. In this case, you've got a piece of property that really cannot be appraised as a golf course in its current state. You got a desert out there. You got a mud bowl when it rains. And so you project, what do you think it could do? I think that probably what, if it went this way, the value of that property would be just for land only, and as golf course land, which is like open space land. And I would guess that, here again, I don't know, because if I say something, you all will remember this, and it comes back to haunt. But I would say off the top of my head, you're probably looking at, how much can you pay for a piece of golf course land? Probably you're looking at $500,000 to $800,000, somewhere in that ballpark. And because you're going to have to put in, I don't know what the irrigation system is like. You're going to have to add money onto that to restore this thing. You're going to have not a whole lot of grading because the golf course is already laid out. But I don't know what goes on with the pumps and the lakes. You got a little item called a clubhouse that's going to have to be restored because the other one mysteriously burned down. And you've got equipment to buy, you got golf cars to buy, you've got restaurant equipment to buy. I mean, and probably to restore that thing, you're probably all, if you take one big ball of wax and somebody who really knows what they're doing and puts their heart and soul in it, and because Don, you're right. I mean, it's the passion and the love of game that leads people into this thing. But you're probably looking at probably somewhere between $2.5 and $3 million to get that thing up and going as a golf course again. I'm just guessing. I don't know. And when we find out whether it's, if it's possible to even get that far with it, we've got somebody lined up who can probably within 2 weeks give us a good, hard, fast bid-type number on what it would cost to restore that golf course. These are people that have done this many, many times over for many years. So right now we're just trying to get where we can actually address that problem.
Thank you, buddy. I would like to just break in for a moment, and I'm going to invite all of you to stay around as long as you want to ask questions. But there's a couple things. I see people heading for the exits, and it's already after 8 o'clock.
Holy cow.
No, I won't trip on that. I do need to talk about some practical issues, and one of them is money. And I hate to do it. We didn't intend to bring you in here to try to get money out of your wallet. But the fact of the matter is, we are a volunteer organization. There is not a single person here who's got millions of dollars. We don't have a multi-million dollar company behind us paying for our ads in the Foothills News. Those cost somewhere between $2,000 and $4,000 per week. And we don't have that kind of money. So we need revenue from the residents to make that up. And if you notice, I think we've had maybe one article or one ad in the Foothills News that cost us about $2,000. And that's stretching our budget to do that. We have a lot of expenses, printing, and those kinds of things. So let me summarize by saying, if you can possibly see a way to do it, make a donation. This is your community. Pete said some of you are losing $50,000 in value on your home. Think of a $100 check or a $25 check or whatever you can afford as a portion, just a tiny little bit of what you have to lose if this thing goes south. Let's all make a down payment if we can. Now, the other thing I want to tell you is that this whole program from tonight will be on our website in a couple of days. And that is www.savethelakes.weebly.com. And you can go on and you can see this whole thing repeated. Yes, I understand that. And I want to just say again, stick around. We'll stay and answer questions until they throw us out. What did I say earlier tonight? We'll be done by midnight.
Thank you, man. My name is Jan Radcliffe. I've lived in Ahwatukee since 1976. Can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Okay. My name is Jan Radcliffe, and I've lived in Ahwatukee since 1976. And this is, I'm in my second home here now. I love Ahwatukee. I attended a meeting Tuesday night. It was sponsored by Ahwatukee Moving Forward. Ahwatukee Moving Forward is, I call it AKA True Life, because I think they're, personally, I think they're funded by True Life. I can't prove that, but that's just my opinion. So I asked a question at this meeting on Tuesday, and the question was regarding the consent form that some of you may have already signed from for True Life to sign away the CC&Rs. At the bottom of that form, it says that if you want to rescind your signature, you've got 7 days from the date of the form that you sign. So my question to Tim is that legal to put that on a piece of paper that people are signing that they only have 7 days to rescind their signature?
You know, this is a part I hate. You ask a lawyer a question, especially one who's been around the block a couple times, and you'll hear that, well, maybe, maybe not. And the reason is that any lawyer worth their salt, if they've done their homework and thought about what they're trying to accomplish and what facts they've been given and what the circumstances are and what the law is and who the judge might be, can write it the way they want to write it. And sure enough, they're here to argue. And I understand that there was an attorney here Tuesday evening that said, you can't do it. I can't tell you that it's legal or it's not legal, because there's no such thing in the civil area as what's legal or not. It's a question of whether it's enforceable. And what's enforceable is open to debate. And from my perspective, and I have seen this consent, and I've read through the CC&R that they have put on their website, and I can only tell you that I can think of some arguments why it's not enforceable. And I'm talking about the last sentence of that consent. Whether I'm right or not, don't know. That would be up to some judge. And so to that extent, I really cannot give you a definitive one way or the other. I can just tell you I have an opinion. And I've been doing it long enough. I think my opinion is at least based on some kind of a sane opinion. But at the same time, it's not my decision, because what's going to happen? I'm anticipating. We're set to go to trial in June of 2017. If between now and then there is 51% of the owners within the area that is delineated in the CC&Rs, in the legal description, if 51% agree that the CC&Rs can be amended, then under the CC&Rs, it's very clear. It's done. It's done. And what I anticipate will happen at that point is that True Life will come to the court and say, dismiss the lawsuit, because in fact, we now have 51% who have approved it. And from my perspective, we're not just going to turn on our heel and leave. We're going to make sure that they truly have 51% and that it's all done according to Hoyle. And to that end, you know, I can't tell you how that might play out. I can only tell you what my thought process is. And that's not telling secrets out of school, because it's clear. I said at the beginning, these CC&Rs are very clear in my mind, very clear in my mind. And part of that is that if you own the property, you operate a golf course. If 51% of the homeowners decide they want to change it, that's your absolute right. And it no longer has to be a golf course. So the question will become, if they get 51% in their mind before our trial starts, they're going to have to come to the court and say, Judge, let us off the hook. We're done. And then that will take some kind of a process, and we'll go from there. So, and we'll find out at that point.
Thank you, Tim. Ben, we've got a question from back here.
My name is C.H. Liu. I came to Arizona in 1957 as professor of chemistry at ASU. I retired in 1995. I'm still alive, so. The question I had in mind is, are there some examples in the past? Can we legally stop him, or stop the builder? And if so, how much will it cost? And do people here, or are we willing to put it up, so to speak? Thank you.
In other words, has there been precedent to stop this? Has there been a process that we know of, that this process has been stopped before, when somebody's trying to change?
Are we talking about a legal process?
We're talking about the event happening of someone wanting to change the CC&Rs so they can build something that it wasn't, that the property was not originally intended for.
There certainly have been legal cases dealing with the change of CC&Rs. I can't say that there's any in Arizona that deal with ones in which there's a golf course at issue. And I will say this, that the CC&R that was written for by the Presley company is not unique, but it's one of very few I'm discovering based upon the legal golf course cases around the country, because there are a number of those where the golf courses are being sold. So I really don't know that there's precedent as far as changing the CC&Rs, but there is precedent involving golf courses. There's precedent in changing CC&Rs in cases dealing with that. So that's why, from my perspective, if there is a 51%, we're going to make certain that it is absolutely, from our point of view, done according to Hoyle, and then we'll see where that leaves us.
All right. Thank you, Tim. I'll put this back up here a bit.
Open mic.
I'm Gladys Hour. I've lived in Ahwatukee a little over 20 years. My question is, at this point, do we know how many signatures we have to retain the CC&Rs? How many people have actually, households have actually signed?
Question is, do we know how many people have signed the petition to retain the CC&Rs, the petition that we had out front when you came in? Anybody know that?
I can answer that partially by saying that 2 years ago when we went through the petition drive, we had around 2,300 petitions supporting keeping the CC&Rs. Now, 2,300 goes a long way toward being 50% of 5,200. It's a little bit short, but if you stop and think about it, 2,300 signatures supporting puts them in a real bind to get 2,700 to overtake it. And they have to get to 51%. Your goal and our goal is to get enough signatures to stop them from getting 51%. And there are people out there that don't really give a hoot one way or the other who aren't going to sign anything. That's essentially a no vote for them. So keep that in mind. Now, while this petition issue came up, I also want to remind you that we are accepting petition signatures in the foyer. And we've been told by our attorney that some of those signatures ought to be refreshed. In other words, the 2014, we should refresh them. So if you are vacillating about signing a new petition, that's the reason we would like you to do it. So we can say, hey, here is a petition that was signed in 2016, and it's valid. So please don't pass it up and say, well, I already signed one 2 years ago. Let's keep the thing going. Now, we're getting down to the end of our time here. And again, I think all of these gentlemen will stick around as long as you want to ask them questions. I got a whole bunch of people to say thank you to, and I want to do that and recognize them briefly before you all leave. So, we had a whole bunch of people here last Saturday out delivering flyers to the neighborhoods, advertising this event. There were about 25 or 30 of them that hit the streets on Saturday. We referred to it as carpet bombing. We just went out and put a lot of flyers out to people. So I'd like to recognize them, and I won't start calling them by name because we won't get out here till midnight. But anyway, thanks to those people who did that volunteer work. I look at them, and I can see them sitting all over the place. There's four women that really put this whole thing together. I'm going to call them by name because I can get through that in a hurry. And then hold your applause until I've named all four of them and give them a hearty, hearty round of applause. Deb Karkowski, she has spent hours and hours and hours on this. Linda Swain, Loretta Sywek, and Barb Lachey. Now I'll give them a good round of applause. I certainly want to thank all the panelists. These guys are volunteers too. There are no checks waiting for them at the door. So, and a big thank you to Jim Elwood, who stepped forward to be the moderator tonight. For your information, this program tonight has been recorded. And as I mentioned earlier, you can call it up on our website and watch it over and over and over. Do we have a prize for the person that watches it the most? I don't think we do. So that really is essentially what we're doing tonight. We have, I think, completed the task for the evening. I really want to thank all of you for coming out tonight. You know, when we organize an event like this, the worst nightmare in the world is to walk in here and see 250 empty chairs. And you guys were great for coming out tonight, and we really do appreciate it. Let me just wrap it up by saying thank you, thank you, thank you, and have a safe trip home, and hang in there with us.